On behalf of the Hillsdale College Biology Department and the Science Division, I'd like to welcome all of you to the unveiling of our newest specimen, a magnificent dinosaur skeleton from the Badlands of North Dakota. I wish our museum was large enough to fit everyone inside. Fortunately, Mr. Scott Pienta and Catherine Blonde have worked tirelessly over the past couple of days to set up monitors and audio equipment so that people outside of the museum can all see and hear this special event. And so please join me in thanking them for their good work and helping make this a special event. Once the dinosaur is unveiled, those of you outside the museum will be able to make your way inside to see the specimen firsthand. One thing that I think I can safely say is that with two dinosaurs, we now have the smallest dinosaur museum in the world. The formal portion of this ceremony will last about 15 or so minutes, so if it seems like I'm going to go on too long, you can rest assured we'll be ready to see this thing soon. When we unveiled our first dinosaur, I spoke at some length about our museum's fascinating history. Although I would love to speak for an hour on that topic, I won't repeat all of that information today. However, for those that were not present and for those who are visiting for the very first time, I'd like to begin by sharing a few highlights of our history that have led to this special day, yet another momentous occasion in the fascinating history of our little museum. On March 6th, our museum will turn 144 years old. It began as the passion of Dr. Daniel Moses Fisk, who was hired as the first chair of the natural sciences at Hillsdale College in the summer of 1872. Fisk has since become known as the father of the sciences at Hillsdale. He was also the founder of Hillsdale College's newspaper, The Collegian. During his 12 years here, Fisk built one of the finest college museums in all the West. It occupied much of the first floor of the old Knowlton Hall of Science, where Moss Hall now stands. It was filled with the kinds of specimens that you would usually only see at a major public museum. It included pre-Columbian cultural artifacts, an Egyptian mummy, flintlock pistols from the Revolutionary War, American colonial currency, Civil War artifacts, thousands of pounds of fossils and mineral specimens, and plant and animal specimens from around the world. In 1880, the museum embarked on one of its greatest endeavors. It teamed up with the Smithsonian Institution to fund a two-year collecting expedition across the South American continent. The museum became a campus and community icon, and people would travel by horse and buggy and steam train from around the region to see the curiosities in the Hillsdale College Museum. The museum was so valued as a resource that it was prominently boasted about on all of the published advertising of the college at the time. There were even funds and plans to build a stand-alone museum building. Unfortunately, Fisk left Hillsdale College in 1886. The museum had lost its passionate champion, and the building was never built. The existing museum remained in its cramped quarters until 1910. When tragedy struck, a fire ravaged Knowlton Hall. Much of the collection survived, but it was strewn around campus for 4 years, during which time many items were lost. However, in 1914, the museum was reassembled in Knowlton Hall, where it remained until the 1960s, when it was dismantled. Tragically, most of the priceless specimens, artifacts, and other items were thrown in the garbage or given away. In 1998, we began assembling the specimens that remained of the old museum. They were scattered in drawers and shelves throughout the Strozacker Science Building. Finally, in 2008, thanks to the leadership of Drs. Chris Van Orman and Frank Steiner, permission was given to use this room to rebuild our museum. And on March 7th, 2011, it was rededicated and open again to visitors for the first time in nearly half a century. I like to think that the museum has become the front porch of the science division. And like Hillsdale College itself, what it lacks in size, we have and will continue to compensate for in quality. Reminds me of a quote when Ronald Reagan visited the college and he talked about Little Hillsdale and how it casts such a long shadow. Today, as in the past, the museum is more than a display of curiosities. In addition to specimens on display, it has many thousands more that are stored out of sight and are used for research and classroom instruction. For many, the specimens that we most associate with the Natural History Museum, the ones that we most want to see, are dinosaurs. A Natural History Museum just isn't quite the same without at least one of these monsters. Yet few small museums have them because they are large, hard to acquire, and extremely expensive, usually in the hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars. There are entire states in the Union that don't have a single dinosaur within their borders. There are many museums have dinosaurs that are only casts and have little, if any, real bones. Having a dinosaur, let alone two dinosaurs, which have a large percentage of real bone, is unprecedented for a college of our size. The dinosaur we are about to unveil was made possible through the unbelievable generosity of Tyler and Caitlin Horning. Both are graduates of Hillsdale College, class of 2006. Although Tyler was a marketing major, was Caitlin marketing too? Of all things, Tyler elected to take my geology class as an elective. So, and where, among other things, he learned about dinosaurs and their world. I couldn't have possibly imagined at the time that he would be giving us a world-class dinosaur specimen only 11 years later. Now, Tyler is an interesting character. I was very suspicious of Tyler when he was a student here, because he was just too nice and extremely mature for his age. He handled himself like a seasoned business professional. As I got to know him over the years, however, I became less suspicious of him because I finally realized that he is just a genuinely nice guy. We are so proud to have him and Caitlin as alumni of our great college and delighted to have him with us today. On behalf of Dr. Chris Van Orman, Dean of the Science Division, Dr. Frank Steiner, Chair of the Biology Department, the biology faculty, and the entire Hillsdale College family, I'd like to recognize and thank Tyler and Caitlin for this unbelievable gift.
Well, thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Swinehart. Well, I'm just humbled to be here with all of you, that all of you thought it interesting enough that we have a dinosaur here at Hillsdale to come and see this on the first or second day back on classes?
Second day
back on classes. So thank you for being here. This dinosaur brings a couple things to mind. One is that it took a team. Dr. Swinehart, Mr. Braswell, who uncovered the dinosaur, his wife, who supported him in uncovering the dinosaur, and a Dr. Steve Nicholas, who can't be here with us today, but who kind of coordinated all of this and actually put the complete specimen together. So it really took all the efforts of all of those folks together to make this happen. What that also leads me to believe is, or leads me to think about, is what it took to get to this point. This dinosaur is 66 million years old. It's been in the ground for 66 million years. And just think about all that happens in the 2,000 years or the 4,000 years or the 10,000 years that we can comprehend. This is millions, 66 millions. And just what has happened since this dinosaur's been in the ground just blows your mind. Last night, preparing for this, Caitlin and I watched this video where it pictured the history of the Earth as a flight from Los Angeles to New York City. And so you're flying across the country and, you know, life starts somewhere in the Midwest and then plants, you know, take over the land and, you know, time goes on. The dinosaurs appear midway in Pennsylvania. So we've gotten from California to Pennsylvania. The dinosaurs are alive basically through the state of Pennsylvania. And our period of time on that scale is a couple of feet. And the time that we can kind of comprehend is a couple of feet in that whole journey. So just mind-blowing when you start thinking about those things. And the first dinosaur, Dr. Schweiner, you can correct me if I'm wrong on this, but the first dinosaur is further away from this dinosaur than this dinosaur is to Justin Bieber. So think about that. That was on the internet. It must be true, right? But again, just having something like this here at Hillsdale and having the opportunity for students to be able to see this, whether it's college students or young kids, and that's a big hope of mine that, you know, young kids will be able to see this. We have a 4-year-old and a 1-year-old, and their eyes just get big when they see things like this, and it's just great to see that the wonder of the world that we live in and to see it through their eyes, and hopefully this dinosaur will bring a little bit of that back to all of us who may be a bit jaded in life. So 66 million years and what it's taken to get here, and the team that brought it. So thank you, Dr. Schweinhardt, and thanks for everybody being here.
You see what I mean? He's a professor. He doesn't even need notes. It's wonderful. Well, it's about that time. What you're about to see is a mostly complete skeleton of a plant-eating dinosaur called Triceratops horridus, a type of horned dinosaur that roamed the subtropical floodplain environments of what is now the Dakotas, Wyoming, Colorado, Montana, and Alberta. The species existed between 66 million years ago and 68 million years ago. It was among the last dinosaur species to roam the Earth before their reign was cut short by an asteroid strike. The species reached a length of up to 29 feet and weighed up to 26,000 pounds. This particular specimen was first discovered by Jim Braswell on a private ranch within the Hell Creek Formation in southwest North Dakota. Jim and his wife, Donna, flew up from Alabama to be with us today. Let's give them a warm Hillsdale College welcome. Jim will be around after the unveiling, and I am sure he'd be happy to share with you the story of how he found the dinosaur, so make sure you introduce yourself. It is a tradition to give dinosaurs nicknames associated with the person who found the animal. You may have heard of the T-Rex named Sue, the famous T-Rex at the Field Museum of Natural History in Chicago, which was named for Sue Hendrickson, who discovered it. Jim, being a little more generous and modest, named our Triceratops Donna in honor of his lovely wife. What an honor. Now, there might be some ladies that may not take it as an eye, you know, name after. Specimen was excavated by faculty and students of both Hillsdale College and the University of North Georgia. One of our students was involved in the dig. Lily Carville conducted her senior thesis on the dig site. The dinosaur was assembled and prepared by Dr. Steve Nicholas and his staff in Cumming, Georgia. It was transported in a very large truck by our own Marty Morrison from the maintenance department, biology major Doug Phillips, and myself. And while Marty did 99.9% of the driving. I think all three of us had white knuckles coming back with a dinosaur in the back, an invaluable specimen in the back of that truck. Thankfully, we didn't encounter any icy roads. The dinosaur is comprised of a large percentage of real bone with cast bones filling in the missing pieces. It is mounted in a two-dimensional relief, not unlike the one behind you there and in front of you, which is one of the oldest methods of displaying a dinosaur. In fact, the very first mounted dinosaur in the United States was mounted this same way in the Peabody Museum at Yale University. I will note, too, that make note when you examine the skull that there is a hole in the frill, and that hole was from a battle with another Triceratops. So that's kind of interesting. There are at most only three places in the state of Michigan where you can go and see a real bone skeleton of dinosaur. We know for sure at the University of Michigan Museum of Natural History and maybe the Michigan State University, although we haven't confirmed that that one's real bone yet. And then of course Hillsdale College. With the exception of about a dozen people, you are the first to see this 66 million year old animal. So now it is with great pleasure that I introduce you to Donna, the newest member of the science division at Hillsdale College. And I'm gonna need to be right there, and then my assistant Ryan will be on the other side.